Good afternoon. I'm Danielle Conway, and you are watching Life in the Law on the ThinkTech Talk series. Today is a very special program for me, and I hope it'll be for you. I'm interviewing today Anna Elento-Sneed, who is a shareholder director of the law firm Alston, Hunt, Floyd, and Ng, and her daughter, Samantha Sneed, who is a new associate to the firm. Today's show is going to be about law and legacies. Want to talk to them personally, but also see the direction in which their firm is going. Welcome, Anna.
Hi.
Welcome, Samantha.
Hi.
So like I said, it's a very important show for me because not only have I had the pleasure of being mentored by Anna, your mother, I've had the pleasure of teaching you and hopefully mentoring you as a graduate of the William S. Richardson School of Law. So I hope that's the case, but we'll talk a little bit about that. Anna, as I said, I met you about 14 years ago. Mm-hmm. From the moment I met you, you've been that kind of pioneering, mentoring person. Where did that come from? Where did you get that responsibility?
Probably from my mother. My mother.
Okay.
She was a teacher, and she spent a lot of time teaching us, you know, how to be responsible, to do our jobs, don't do anything halfway. And so learn that and pass it on.
Yeah, you were very good at that. When I first met you two, I knew from the moment I met you, you were driven. You still are driven.
Yeah. Driven crazy, but yes.
How quickly did you become a partner in a law firm? It wasn't Alston Hunt where you were partner.
No, actually, it was at Carl Smith, which is now Carl. It was Carl Smith Wickman Case at the time, Wickman Case, and now it's Carl Smith Ball.
So you made partner at that firm.
Right.
What was your path to the law? What did you study? Where were you? And where did you graduate from?
Actually, I decided in 10th grade that I was going to be a lawyer.
Neat.
And I found out after, and I was going to be a labor lawyer.
You knew that in 10th grade?
Knew that in 10th grade. And that's because my mom was a union leader. And actually, you'll find that most union leaders' kids become lawyers.
Interesting.
I thought I was going to be on labor, you know, union side. But when I came out of law school, they had no jobs. So the next thing that was available in the area that I wanted to do was management. So I ended up on the opposite side.
How did your mother feel about that?
She was okay with it. I think the first negotiations I had were my uncle was across the table was a little odd, but you know, when your family is across the table, it makes for a much more, I guess you call it jovial negotiations, but it was all right.
How did that negotiation turn out?
We settled peacefully, no strike.
And still had turkey dinner.
And we still had turkey dinner.
That's a good story. I didn't know that.
Yep.
And so from that moment on, you were a management lawyer.
So when I... you know, when I decided in high school that I was going to do this, I picked my college and
based on that.
Right, based on where I could get into law school.
Now, at the time, there was no William S. Richardson School of Law.
No.
I don't want to date you.
Yeah. So I went to school at UC Berkeley.
UC Berkeley. Mm-hmm. And we've had a couple of our faculty members
who
graduated from Berkeley. So it's a long line of folks.
That's right.
But you entrusted your children with our law school.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so you have two.
I have two. She's graduated, done, almost out of the house.
Out of the house.
Kind of. And then I have one that's just finished up her first year at Richardson.
Yeah, so she's a first year rising up to second year.
Right.
Excellent. So when you were raising your kids, and I know you from work, and I never really had much exposure to your kids. I heard a lot about them. But when you were raising them, were you priming them to be lawyers or just good citizens?
Actually, probably good citizens. I think they could see how many hours I worked. And, you know, they would tag along to meetings because sometimes as I'm going to work and I have to go to a morning business meeting, both of them got taken to the business meetings and sat there and ate their pancakes or waffles while I did the business and then took them to preschool. So they knew what it was like, and I don't think they wanted to be lawyers.
Yeah. Is that true, Sam?
I think growing up, my sister and I, you know, we would tag along and we'd see how utterly insane mom's hours and the type of work and everything that she did. And, you know, it's very interesting, but I thought for a long time that I was going to be, you know, a research scientist doing the noble slog out in the middle of a jungle somewhere. And, you know, as I got older, and I still stuck with pursuing science, but I started to realize that, you know, the things that I was good at and the things that I cared about coming from my family were better aligned with the practice of law, mm-hmm. and that I could make an impact through law in the areas that I cared about.
Now, Anna, you were really quite deliberate about the education of your daughters. They went to public schools.
Right.
In Hawaii.
Right.
You chose a particular place where you were going to raise them because you wanted them to be connected to
where people,
their roots are.
Normal
yeah.
people. Mm-hmm. I don't mean that people in private school are not normal, but, you know, I right. would like a wider variety so they
yeah.
get to, used to dealing with
all
people from all different walks of life.
Yeah.
They fully had all of the things, you know, like youth symphony and mm-hmm. outside activities, all the AP classes. So they participated in a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But the public school experience was different, you mm-hmm. know, for them.
Mm-hmm.
And it also, by the way, their grandmother, you know, was a union leader in the public school system. So Popo also had input.
Yeah.
So that happened. And then we made sure they went away for school.
Now, I do want to really talk about what you guys are doing in practice, but the question keeps coming into my mind, how did you do this, raising two children? You have a husband who was a pilot, so you were the parent at home.
Kind of.
Yeah, but you were working hard. How did you do this?
We were lucky because we had both sets of grandparents.
Mm-hmm.
We lived out close to them, so both mm-hmm. sides were about 10 minutes away.
Okay.
And when the girls were young, and I traveled for work,
uh-huh.
and my husband traveled too, so we actually bought a scheduling program,
mm-hmm.
and we actually pushed out weekly schedules. So it'd say who would drop off, who would pick up, what the activities, and every weekend we'd pass it out to the grandparents. So everybody knew whose responsibility it was at what time to do something with the girls. And it just went like that.
Mm-hmm.
And you can do that, you know, when you live close to family. That's one of the reasons we stayed here.
Right.
So it worked out. We were lucky.
Okay. Yeah, I'm amazed because I would watch you at work and everything was on the numbers.
Yes.
Get here at this time, let's do this in this time, because you have other things to do.
Right.
And that's how you
do
succeeded.
Everything.
Well, fantastic. Samantha, how was that for you?
You know, now hearing that my parents had a scheduling program, it all makes sense. you know, when you're 6 years old, you don't really think about,
right.
you know, how big a burden you could be being trucked around all over the place to soccer, to lessons,
right.
to school and whatnot. So I definitely appreciate my parents and grandparents.
There's a lot of pride though. I know your mother's very proud of you because we've talked about you on many occasions. So let's talk about what you've been able to accomplish. You left Hawaii for a little bit. What did you do? And then why did you decide to come back to law school here?
So I went away to the University of Denver and I studied electrical engineering, and the school had a great program where you could get your MBA in just an additional year concurrently with your undergraduate program. So I did that, and I think that was such a great experience,
mm-hmm.
both educationally and to, you know, to go away someplace that's just so completely different from home.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I remember the first 2 or 3 years I'd call up and I'd go, all they eat up here are burgers and fries. I don't know what I'm going to do. I can't make it this
right.
semester. But, you know, I think it was also a good experience in that when you move to someplace new, it takes a while to get adjusted and
mm-hmm.
learn the place and the history and the people and, you know, establish a network there. And so when I graduated, I was tempted to stay up there
mm-hmm.
to work an engineering job because there are a lot of opportunities there. But I started thinking about it and, you know, obviously with a lot of input from mom,
mm-hmm.
Long term, would I want the arc of my career to be in that place in engineering? And, you know, could I envision myself 20 years on doing that?
Mm-hmm.
And what I talked about a lot with mom is what were the other opportunities in law, and she pointed me towards studying government contracts and intellectual property because it's aligned with my background, and then also to contact mm-hmm. you.
Well, the interesting part about that segue is your mom really is a pioneer. So we're going to talk about some of the initiatives she's involved in with advancing the firm in the new century. But one of the things that she pioneered was the expansion of the practice group where you were at Carl Smith. And so you expanded the practice group beyond labor.
Well, right. We mm-hmm. had somebody join us who had retired from the Army. Mm-hmm. And his area was government contracts and labor. Mm-hmm. Not too many people know that 90% of all government contracts is the management of the labor piece. Mm-hmm. So after talking to Terry Thomason, he joined, and we were able to craft together a labor employment government contracts practice, mm-hmm. which was pretty unique for Hawaii because people think of it as very different.
Right.
So we were able to expand, you know, that practice, and we have a lot of clients in that area. And it made sense because Hawaii is, you know, our number two industry, I would say right now, is government related. Mm-hmm. Whether it's the state government or the federal government, there's a lot of businesses that basically do work with the two, you know, mm-hmm. government entities.
And there's no question that Alston Hunt Floyd is actually one of the leaders in representation in this area.
Yeah, we think so.
Yeah, I think so too.
We think so.
But more interesting for me is, did you plan that? Because you knew your daughter was an engineer, and this would just work out great, and she could come work with the firm.
If you ask my partner.
I'm interested in this, too.
No, and the part working with the firm, no. Because that decision was done by other people. She doesn't, like, work with me. She right. works with other people in the firm. But in terms of, you know, planning mm-hmm. things, if you ask my partners, they'll tell you. I plan everything, mm-hmm. And I do plan in decades. Mm-hmm. So I guess when Terry first started, and that's actually when I met you,
yeah.
it was around 1996 mm-hmm. when he first came.
Now you're telling how old I
yeah.
am.
Yeah.
Hey.
And then, you know, Terry didn't think that government contracts, because he'd come out of the federal government. He yeah. said, there's not a lot of it. I said, no, there's a lot. He goes, no, there isn't. I said, yes, there's a lot. And so I kept pushing, and he'll tell me it's all my fault,
yeah.
Anybody. I kept pushing him until he expanded the practice. Mm-hmm. And now we have quite a few attorneys that do labor, employment, government contracts. And we think that area will continue to grow.
Yeah.
Just because of where we're situated and the kind of work that comes in and out of Hawaii.
Mm-hmm. So your mom didn't plan, but sort of planned.
Sort of planned it.
This area where it's relatively new to Hawaii, but it's something that fits right in your wheelhouse in terms of skill set.
Absolutely, and I'm glad that Mom and Terry and, you know, the people at the firm did take that on and developed it, because, you know, after I graduated and I was thinking about coming home mm-hmm. and looking at doing the law, I was trying to figure out where can I best align my skills and my abilities and make a difference in my home.
Mm-hmm.
And is it ultimately going to be best to stay away and do that, or should I come home and try to make the difference?
Now, you mentioned your master's in business. Your mom is absolutely one of the leaders in innovation and business development in relation to legal services here in Hawaii and probably globally. So tell me how the kind of work that you are doing is going to advance Hawaii. Tell me what Alston Hunt Floyd & Ng is doing that's going to innovate and advance Hawaii's position in the world today.
You know, one of the things that, and Mom and I have talked about this at length, where we think that Hawaii is really a leader globally, is that culturally, people have an inherent understanding that we're all interconnected and that we all need one another.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think what Hawaii lacks, though, is a lot of maybe the hard skill sets or techniques, sort of the nitty-gritty things that we haven't necessarily had an opportunity to develop here over the decades that maybe larger markets on the mainland or internationally have.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's part of the reason I came back, is that, you know, when you go away as a kid from Hawaii,
mm-hmm.
there's always sort of this thing in the back of your mind that maybe you do have this obligation to come home and add that body of knowledge that you've gained to mm-hmm. back into the community that you came from.
Right.
It's kind of funny, excuse me, because I'm part of this group called the Employment Law Alliance, which mm-hmm. it's a global network of labor and employment attorneys, and we're in 130 countries. So when I sit with them, it's true. People from Hawaii, I don't know if it's because of the way we grow up, small space, a lot of different cultures. We kind of gravitate to learning things, eating things, doing everything with mm-hmm. with people from different countries. So it's much easier to communicate and to relate to them.
Right.
And I think that kind of soft skill, actually, for a lot of Hawaii business people, they would find very useful if they had the courage to move out of Hawaii. As well as, you know, for some of the Hawaii people that are on the mainland coming back. There's a lot of opportunities, but it takes courage at home, mm-hmm. as well as courage from the people who are on the mainland to come home.
Mm-hmm. And I've seen you at work. That's part of your practice, really facilitating right. those relationships.
Right, so I've met a number of people, mm-hmm. you know, who have come back after, you know, working on the mainland for a while mm-hmm. and want to come home.
Yeah.
You know, and I keep telling them, you can do it. And right. they've been pretty successful at it.
Yeah, and the firm is actually a testament to that, because a lot of the attorneys that you have coming in are people either who have no connection to Hawaii mm-hmm. or people who are returning home.
Right.
And that's sort of a theme of this show, Life and the Laws, people returning home, sort of the brain trust coming back into Hawaii for the benefit of Hawaii. Now, you've spent your entire career here. Have there been any challenges that you have had to deal with or navigate in your career, particularly as a woman of color?
I don't think it's so much anything of a woman of color. It was kind of funny. Early in my career, at one of the firms, they brought in a consultant mm-hmm. to say, okay, what can you do to increase your business development and to get more clients to want to bring you their business. Mm-hmm. And so we went through this whole rigmarole, and at the end he said, well, the one thing I can give you advice on is maybe you should dye your hair gray. Because if you look older, then they'll trust you more. And I'm sitting there going, okay, that's just not going to happen. I'm not going to dye my hair gray.
Right.
Now I have it.
That'll happen soon enough.
So, it, you know, but I think what it is just being a lawyer is a lot of hard work.
Yeah.
Because you really need to know the law. Mm-hmm. You need to know the business of law, which I think is not something that's taught in the law schools, mm-hmm. that it's a business and you have to make it operate mm-hmm. successfully. Mm-hmm. And then you have to learn your clients' businesses, because to be of value to them, you need to appreciate what they have to go through mm-hmm. so you can give them options and advice on how to deal with all their legal issues.
That's exactly right.
So that's the difficulty. So.
Sam, have you found that a benefit in your skill set, that master's in business, to understand or appreciate at least that law is a business?
Absolutely. And I think comparing my experience in law school to business school, there's sort of, I don't know if you'd call it like a slight difference in perspective, where the law as a community seems to tend a little more insular, where it stays within the statutes, and there's a tendency to think that that's the boundaries of my existence as a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And the business community is exactly the opposite. It's always what's outside of our organization that we need to bring in to make us better. Mm-hmm. And I think it would be valuable for both communities to sort of see, I guess, the other perspective. And I think it'd be hugely valuable, especially for students before they go out into the industry of law, mm-hmm. to understand that, you know, just because it is a very specialized field does not make your business special
right.
in and of itself. Yeah, and it's not necessarily the nature of what you do so much as you need to realize that you're still part of a larger economy, a larger community, and that you have to abide by and you're subject to these rules.
Mm-hmm. Well, when we come back from our break, I'll ask Anna and I'll ask Samantha about the industry of law. This is Danielle Conway. You're watching Life and the Law on the ThinkTech Talk series. Back in a moment.
Hello, I'm Martin Despang, and I'm the host together with the one and only Ali Amashta, and our show is called Urban Transcendence. And Urban Transcendence is about identifying where we have a unique situation of a vibrant city in one of the most beautiful natural environments. So how these two can coincide, sometimes conflict, how they could find reciprocity in the 21st century is what we're excited about. And we're planning on bringing in a diverse body of guests, both from the arts and the science, and the established and the wise and the emerging generation. So hope you will join us. We'll always be on Thursdays from 1 to 2 p.m. Thank you.
Welcome back. I'm Danielle Conway. You're watching Life in the Law in the ThinkTech Talk series. My guests today are Anna Elento-Sneed from the law firm Alston, Hunt, Floyd & Ng, and Samantha Sneed. And they share a last name because they are related, mother and daughter lawyers at the firm. Welcome back. So we last finished off the segment talking about law as an industry. And you said something really provocative, Samantha. It's not provocative to most people in business, but it is provocative to lawyers. Law is an industry like almost any other industry, and it has to operate as such. I want to ask you to talk about that more, but also talk about how social benefits can also be achieved thinking about law as an industry.
Mm-hmm. So I think one of the things that we've talked about, I think all of us before, is just noting that the changes and the pressures increasing in laws and industry are really just sort of the echo of everything that's happened to every other industry, where we're starting to see with the wider spread and improvements in technology that services of all kind are becoming more democratized. And so because laws and industry for so long has been so insular, we haven't been as affected. Mm-hmm. And it probably helps that as lawyers we can protect ourselves in some way, but you know, you can only hold off the future for so long. Mm-hmm. But ultimately I think this is a good thing, because I mean, what clients now are looking for is what they get with all of their other service providers, that they get a predictable, consistent product that meets the needs of their business. Mm-hmm. And so I think ultimately it's a good thing for lawyers not only to engage in an economic sense, but also to recognize that their clients have these very distinct needs that they need to meet.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And I think lawyers, there are lawyers, and it's kind of interesting because I think the Europeans are ahead of Americans on this, mm-hmm. That recognize that law is an industry. There are people who study the industry,
right,
and approach, and they're starting to question the hourly approach. Mm-hmm. I guess the words or the buzzwords they use for it now is alternative billing, mm-hmm. but it's not. It's more than just a flat rate. It's a different way of looking at how clients consume the services that we provide, mm-hmm. and how they fit that into their needs. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you YouTube and talk about changes in the industry, you'll find lots of different presentations about how law is changing. The days mm-hmm. when we could have legal factories and everybody charging by the hour and increasing rates are beginning to, you know, roll back. Mm-hmm. Clients are resenting it. There are certainly some areas where you can still bill by the hour. Litigation tends to be like that.
Right.
But more and more of it is being what the Europeans call commoditized. Mm-hmm. And because with the internet, the technology, the rise in the consultants, you know, mm-hmm. they consult about everything, mm-hmm. And just, you know, the economic pressures, people can't afford
right.
to consume legal services the same way. So lawyers are beginning to look at different ways to provide the services, and what do the clients truly need, the value.
Right.
Where do you add the value?
And that's where I can see a connection between hiring competent lawyers, but also receiving a social benefit. Because if we can change or transform from this hourly billing rate in the industry, legal services can be more accessible to many more entities, organizations, or individuals.
And you see that. I mean, I know of some very large firms. I'm thinking of particular one, a very prominent firm in Australia, and several in the UK that deal with EU issues, where they will, quote, partner with their clients on a particular project, and they will quote a particular flat rate, or just the project rate. And if the client wins, there's an upside for the firm, the premium. If the client does not achieve a certain result, they just get paid for the project. And then what happens is they put all their best people into it. And they, from what I hear, talking to those firms, they don't necessarily worry about the hour, because what they're trying to do is get that premium where they will make their profit. So it's the result. So it aligns the firm with the client's goals.
Right.
And they seem to be very successful at it. But of course, a lot of that depends on how much technology you have, how good you are at analyzing the numbers and figuring out what your actual return is.
Right.
And you know, lawyers, we went to law school because we didn't want to be accountants. So there we go. So that's the challenge.
Right.
You know.
But this kind of analysis that you're talking about is really data driven, and that means looking behind what you provide as a legal service and looking at how you provide it.
That's true.
Okay.
And I think that's one of the things that's difficult for law firms, because software. Software is always the challenge. I think there are more and more companies developing better software where you can take your billing information and then do the analytics to figure out what's actually happening. But a lot of that is in its infancy. Even project management software for law firms is still pretty much in its infancy. It's not like we can take an engineering project software, management software, and go forward.
But again, some would say that you really planned this out because you went and sent your daughter off to get an engineering degree, and she's interested in software development. So it seems like you sort of set this all in
motion.
She can
look at the software.
She
for
can.
Me.
This was planned.
Yeah. How did you do that again? That's But do you see that, or are you in line with my thinking that this actually opens doors for those who otherwise would never have an opportunity to? And then the other thing that I see, and Samantha, tell me if you're starting to see this, it also means that junior associates, the new people that you bring in, can actually service these clients who are new to legal services and actually get and build expertise as a junior associate.
Absolutely, and I mean, I think the better your systems are within the firm, the shorter the training time there is for young lawyers like me to become, you know, to slowly build up our practice and our skill set so that we can do more complex work for clients. But in the meantime, if you are able to parcel out the type of work that law demands, it's also helpful for the client because they can use somebody with lower billing rates, and for us and for young associates to actually have the enjoyment and the experience of working with clients directly.
Right.
And I think for this, what you can do is if you can, there are firms, for example, large firms in the United States and definitely again in the EU that are doing what they call mapping. And what they do is they map out the cases to figure out each step and look for patterns. And once they establish the patterns, they figure out templates. And it's not like everybody's going to get a cookie cutter.
Right.
But what you have at least is the beginning, so someone doesn't stare at a blank page, or as they say, reinvent the wheel. Here's the wheel, now fix it to fit the car. And so that's what they're doing. And they're finding it, it teaches those. You can push work down to lower rated people. There is one firm in particular, I'm thinking out of UK, where their highest rate of growth in hiring is in what they call their TSD, which is basically transactional services. And what they do is it's all done by paralegals. who are supervised by mid-range lawyers. Mm-hmm. And then the senior lawyers go out, and I'm sure they bill by the hour, to do the advising with the clients. So you take more experience and skills, and you provide a higher level of service. Mm-hmm. And the grinding work is done by people, you know, at the appropriate level. So the big pyramid, you know, that you think of becomes something very skinny, where the name is, the name of the game is to be the advisor, the business advisor,
right,
to the clients, and
and to provide more dynamic service,
right,
at that level,
right,
not the operational service or the skill service,
right,
and it's more modular too, which I think is what a lot of other industries have seen change, in that the client, maybe if they aren't in the position to pay for the whole suite of services, they can choose which part that they need help with, and they can pay accordingly.
Exactly.
And you know, you talk about the millennials being different, because it takes a lot of technology to be able to coordinate all of this, and
they know it.
They know it.
Yeah. My three-year-old does this.
Yes.
This is.
And I carry it with programs.
It's awesome. But it's true.
It's true.
It's true. And what that is not only creating access, but it's also creating efficiencies. And that means transforming legal services, not just for institutional clients, but actually for individual clients.
Right.
And that's something really spectacular for Hawaii, I think, because we have a very large number of small businesses here and individually owned businesses. And many of them go without legal services. So would you say that they could come to Alston Hunt, and Alston Hunt has decided that this can happen, or is this something that Alston Hunt is only thinking about?
No, actually we've been experimenting with it for about 10 years, where we have certain clients on retainers where they pay a monthly or a quarterly fee, and they basically get unlimited advice. If we have litigation, we'll put them off into an hourly, we're more traditional with the litigation and the insurance coverage. But for everyday advice about what to do with employees, you know, how to put together a employment contract, all of that we have, and I have a staff of, they're paralegals, but actually they are HR managers with master's degrees who know, because they were out there in the business doing it. So they come in, the lawyers do the legal work, and they process the work. And so we're about to expand all of that into our, what we call our BizOps center, so to invite more clients if they want to do that, so that they can get a price certain, you know, because certainty is important for businesses now, and we can do this, you know, now that we have technology, I have more bodies, we can do it for more clients, because it does take a lot of coordination and a lot of technology to do it.
So what you are planning for is the structural change that you see that has occurred in the market.
Yes.
We're not going back.
Well, for my area, labor and employment, it's already happening. My largest competitors on the mainland have already started that process. And so it's not unusual for labor and employment to be like a little canary, because it is, the area is called, for lawyers, labor and employment, but for businesses, it's called human resources management. So it's management of all the people. So it's already gone that way in my area.
Now, Samantha, how does this new structural change in billing and service provision, how does this impact the interest that you have, say, in renewable technology, firms that are on the cusp of being startups? How does this impact your potential client base? Well,
I think in a number of ways. It's fantastic for a lot of these high-tech companies who tend to be a lot smaller, and you have, you know, a small group of people who wear a number of hats, and they not only need to control costs, but they are used to a certain sort of interfacing, you know, very high tech. If at the very least we can bring up the technical capacity in the field of law to match the client's needs, that would make it easier access for them. But at the same time, having those efficiencies built in mean that more of these types of businesses can have better access. And for me personally, coming from an engineering background and seeing and meeting a lot of people who try to translate, you know, they might have a beautiful piece of technology, but they don't know how to bring it to market, or they don't have access to the people who could basically introduce it to the rest of society as a whole. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that access is in the field of law.
Right.
And so to be in an area that acts as a sort of gatekeeper to what is physically possible, to what is practically possible, mm-hmm. I think it's, you want to have all the tools that you can, and you want to make sure that your tools translate to what the tools that your clients are going to be using.
And it seems that Alston Hunt Floyd Ning is liberal and flexible enough to allow those who want to provide this opportunity to clients.
Yeah, I think one of the things that's good about the firm is that it allows each of the individuals to develop their practices the way they see fit. Mm-hmm. Of course, you've got to deal with all the things about professional responsibility, mm-hmm. et cetera. But we do get to develop our practices. That's how the firm has been able to diversify so mm-hmm. fast.
So I don't want to necessarily put you on the spot to ask you specifically about Alston Hunt, but I do want to put you on the spot as a leader in thinking about where the practice of law is going. What is your game plan or approach to succession planning? Do you believe in it? Is it critical for Hawaii in particular? And how do we do it?
For my practice, it's critical because, it's really, while clients need services and they need to have them quickly, and they need to also know that the people who work with them are not going to learn on them,
Right.
So the research, the development of the products, of the services, and the training of your people mm-hmm. is really going to be on your time. And so you have to think about that in structuring. At the same time, you have to give opportunities for the younger lawyers to learn. Mm-hmm. So it takes a while. It's taken me a long while to get someone at the stage where, he can now start mm-hmm. supervising the younger associates, at least with respect to the litigation, which frees me up to do the same thing on the non-litigation matters. So it does take a lot of planning. And mm-hmm. for labor and employment and government contracts, because the field is highly regulated, mm-hmm. It takes about 5 or 6 years, like I say, for the light bulb to go on.
Mm-hmm.
So there is a lot of planning involved in that.
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of like the practice area, the more people can do on the bottom, mm-hmm. it frees up the people above them. And ideally, I want to be able to go out and spend more time with the clients away, because mm-hmm. about 50% of the clients come from non-Hawaii, non-local residents
right.
anymore.
Right.
And increasingly we have more international. It's funny because they might not have a big physical presence.
Mm-hmm.
They may just have one person that's
right.
doing something here, but they still have to deal with issues, which is one of the reasons why I'm in that global network. So I find that I refer work out to the far reaches. Mm-hmm. I've sent work to Lithuania and different countries, and by the same token, I get referrals. So the world, globalization has hit Hawaii.
And it has hit the industry.
And
of
it
law.
Has hit the industry. So, we need to be out there
okay.
for the future.
That makes sense, because in your other capacity, too, I know you work a lot with SHRM, the
right.
Society of Human Resource Managers,
mm-hmm.
and they are global.
Right.
Yeah. And
right.
so even though you're situated in Hawaii, even though you're planning for succession in Hawaii, the people that you have trained up have to be able to operate in the global society.
Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, my planning daughter number
two right.
is more international.
So tell me a little bit about daughter number two. We've been focusing on daughter number one. What have you guided her and instructed her to study in school?
She
she's following in mom's footsteps.
Is she really?
labor and employment, but with an international bent.
So not only has mom, but Popo has obviously touched
that one. Would be Bachan.
Yeah. Oh, okay. That is amazing. Well, you are watching Life in the Law. I'm Danielle Conway. We'll come right back for our last segment with Anna Elento-Sneed and Samantha Sneed. We're talking about life in the law and legacies. Be right back.
I'm Jake Fidel. That's Sharon Moriwaki of the Hawaii Energy Policy Forum. And every Wednesday, we have Hawaii, the state of clean energy. We've been doing it for some time now, and we have some fantastic guests on there, unbelievable guests, who give us insight into what is going on in a very complex, sometimes very confusing, sometimes very disappointing area of progress in the state. So we love doing this. We love meeting them. We love talking to them. We love having their ideas out on the table. So maybe, just maybe, we can all make some sense of what's going on. Sharon, what do you think?
I think that's absolutely correct. We enjoy ourselves meeting with all these people and hearing about the energy and the state of clean energy, and hopefully we advance clean energy for the state. So it's terrific. Join us.
Every Wednesday. Okay, Wednesday is Energy Day.
Energy Wednesday.
4 to 5 p.m. Hawaii, the state of clean energy, here on ThinkTech Hawaii.
Energy Wednesday. See
you there.
Welcome back. I'm Danielle Conway. You're watching Life and the Law in the ThinkTech Talk series. My guests today, Anna Elento-Sneed and Samantha Sneed. Anna is a principal, a director, a partner in the law firm of Alston, Hunt, Floyd, Ning. And Samantha, her daughter, is an associate. And, you know, part of this show is to also talk about the accessibility of the law to people in Hawaii, but to others who are watching, but particularly for people in Hawaii. A lot of people would look at the two of you and say, wow, you know, how do you do that? How do you become that person with that career? And I'd like to spend the last minutes we have together actually talking about that so that other people can emulate what you've done.
I don't know if it got planned that way.
I think for me going into law, it was recognizing that, you know, most of the people I feel like who go into law seem to come from a humanities background. And so there is a perception before you go into law school that, oh, I did a major in English. I don't think I can do law. But mm-hmm. I have found that having come from a scientific technical background has informed my study of the law in a very different way that I really appreciate. And I think that it's very necessary for people to come from multiple disciplines from all over, just as we were talking about how, from a business perspective, how you look outward from the organization coming in. I think a lot of people who think about joining law shouldn't be dissuaded by their background, mm-hmm. but they should know rather that it would inform their practice should mm-hmm. they choose to become a lawyer. And it'll make them more valuable for the clients that they would like to work with.
Yes. I think it's different. Some people go into law because their parents made them do it. Mm-hmm. They couldn't figure out what else to do, but mm-hmm. that seemed like a profitable place.
Right.
I think that will continue, but I think the people that are going to be driven and that are going to find themselves successful, because I think there are some quarters in the world that think that lawyers will eventually go away. Mm. The consultants will take over and you'll mm-hmm. have one lawyer, like a barrister, stand up and do mm-hmm. the courtroom thing and everybody else go away. Mm-hmm. But I think really, if you were gonna go to law school now, it's not just go to college, get good grades and see if you can get into law school. You have to think about when you come out, what is gonna be that? What's mm-hmm. gonna be available? I mean, I think once upon a time, people would go to law school, they were interested in tax, mm-hmm. they would wanna be tax lawyers. And then you saw the accounting firms rise up
right.
and go into management and consulting, and all the tax lawyers went away.
Right, right.
You know, you didn't have as large tax practices. There are other areas of law that's mm-hmm. going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the consultants are going to take over mm-hmm. for less price.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're going to come out, you need to think about what areas are going to need that kind of skill.
Mm-hmm.
And are you interested in doing that and then figuring out where to do it? Because it's just not going to be the same mm-hmm. going in the future. There's going to be a lot more competition, and a lot of the law firms, there's a lot of consolidation. There are mega firms and super mega
mm-hmm.
firms now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some of the people that I deal with, their labor and employment department is like 300 to 400 attorneys.
Right.
You know, that's just one department.
That could subsume the largest firms here altogether.
Right. And that's what's happening. Be the boutiques, what we used to think of little boutiques for labor and employment,
right,
have now become national boutiques, mm-hmm, because what they've done is gobble up, you know, everything
firms
with the consolidation.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of accessibility, is a law degree something that you would recommend to a young person graduating from Mililani High School, as you did?
I think I would recommend it if you know that what you want to do with yourself is that you want to make a difference and meet a need that someone or some group of people in the community have, and that you want to meet that need by using the rules of our society.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that I would, if you're just idly thinking about going into law, if I would, mm-hmm, recommend that somebody put themselves through that.
What do you mean? It wasn't a cakewalk?
I mean, I enjoyed it, and you will learn tremendous amounts, but if you do not have a resolve, or if you do not have a plan, mm-hmm, and if there's no need for what you're planning on doing, it might be effort wasted. And
right.
Yeah, it's really, it's an industry, but it's a service business.
Yeah.
And so you have to know what kind of service you're going to offer to what group of people, and you're actually going to translate, mm-hmm, from law books and the way the legal industry thinks into something the everyday person will understand and know what they're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So you facilitate that. And, mm-hmm, so in order to do that effectively, you need to know a lot of information and be able to synthesize it so, mm-hmm, that it actually comes out with practical solutions for the clients. I know one of the things they hate is these long legal tomes,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
which we used to give out routinely when I, right, first started practicing. You give that to a client right now and they'll fire you.
Right, right.
Because
on
it's
the
not
spot.
Yeah, it's not usable anymore, mm-hmm, for them. The world is going too fast.
Right.
And so you have to keep up. Mm-hmm. So that's the difficulty.
I had a young man come to me, and he wasn't young. I mean, he was a 32-year-old gentleman, and it shocked me that he didn't have real concrete information about what it would take to sit for the LSAT and become a law student. Are we in the legal academy? Are we doing what we need to do to make sure that you have the service providers of the future that you're planning for with your succession planning?
You know what's interesting? I think I've talked to you about this before. I know I've talked to my daughters about it before because their brains are wired a certain way, so trying to organize, help them organize what they're learning. I think we look at law still as a learned profession, but the emphasis on the learned.
Mm-hmm.
And so what happens is you go to law school and the first classes you learn in first year are torts, contracts, property, and civil procedure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You get constitutional law maybe sometime in your second year,
mm-hmm,
which is kind of, when you think about when you come out, it's, mm-hmm, upside down,
mm-hmm,
because you in the United States you start with the Constitution,
mm-hmm,
and then they make these things called laws, but we don't give administrative law,
mm-hmm,
and so the first time they, if they didn't take it in law school, they get this rude awakening the minute they have to go to the Department of Labor or the, mm-hmm, PUC, and they're going, who are these people?
Right.
Why can you tell me what to do? And it's just very different.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we could teach it in a way so people could understand the structure,
mm-hmm,
I think it would be easier for students when they come out. Definitely easy for us who train them as they come into the practice.
Right.
You know.
Because those are the things that you're trying to make more efficient.
Right.
This training experience.
And I think teaching them a little bit about what the practice itself. I know some law schools do that and, mm-hmm, others resist it,
mm-hmm,
but the reality is not everyone can become a judge,
mm-hmm,
out of, you know, straight out of school,
right,
or go in and work for the government where you're going to only do appellate work.
Right.
A lot, the vast majority are going to have to go into the private nonprofit sector where you have to deal with all of these things called, mm-hmm, government agencies and other clients, etc.
Mm-hmm.
And so learning about how to deal with them, how to ask questions, to figure out what am I supposed to do with what you just asked me, would be helpful.
That's the real help.
Probably would contribute to the reputation of the profession.
All right. Well, we've got our marching orders at the William S. Richardson School of Law. I want to thank Samantha Sneed and Anna Elento-Sneed from Alston, Hunt, Floyd, and Ng for coming today and talking about their practice, but also their personal and professional legacies. I'm Danielle Conway. You're watching Life in the Law on the ThinkTech Talk series.